here. The Eagle has landed. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Today, the 20th of July, 2019, it has been half a century since mankind first set foot on the moon. In this video, I'm going to explain why this is of existential importance for our civilization. My name is Henrik Jönsson, and I'm an independent Swedish libertarian entrepreneur and commentator on social and political issues. Was the space race a Cold War dead end, or was it a significant and useful endeavor? And what role, if any, does the government have in putting people on other celestial bodies? If you appreciate my videos, you help me keep making them if you support me using one of the payment options on the left. Without your continued support, this Swedish libertarian channel would not be able to exist. This is Major Tom to Ground Control. I'd encourage you to subscribe using the button below if you've not already done so, and also remember to hit the bell icon so you just might get notified when I release new videos, which I do like a clockwork, every Saturday morning at 8 a.m. Central European Time. Today, I'm talking about the impulse of exploration, the temptation of stagnation, and how the interplay between these two forces define our civilization. Now, come with me to the moon. On the 20th of July, 1969, after traveling for 4 days and 240,000 miles through the extraterrestrial vacuum of space, American astronaut and aeronautical engineer Neil Armstrong became the first human being to set foot on the surface of the moon. The spacecraft that had brought him and his two fellow astronauts, Edwin Buzz Aldrin and Michael Collins, to the lunar surface had less computational power than a 1980s Commodore 64 home computer. After 30 orbits around the moon with this 8-bit machine as the main intelligence unit, the touchdown location was deemed unsuitable. Finally, Aldrin took manual control of the spacecraft, and as a fifth of the world's population watched in awe, he successfully navigated the Eagle to safe ground with just 15 seconds of fuel to spare, in a truly breathtaking triumph of engineering brilliance and human spirit. The lunar landing was truly the defining moment of a new era, as it made good on President John F. Kennedy's ambition 8 years earlier of successfully putting a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
During the period of 1969 through 1972, 12 brave men walked on the moon. During a time that briefly became known as the Space Age. The space program was expensive and was partly motivated by the Cold War arms race with the Soviet Union, in which the development of ever more sophisticated long-range ballistic missiles played a key role. During its peak years before the Apollo missions to the moon, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, short for NASA, received over 4% of the total federal budget in funding. As a libertarian, it's easy to criticize the government for seizing billions of decent, hardworking people's money through taxation, only to proceed to pump it into various costly government programs, even daring programs like space exploration. And I will return to this legitimate criticism in a moment, but first, we need to establish an underlying, much grander motif which underpins, drives, and informs all civilizations of mankind. The great duality of mankind is represented in the ancient religions and mysteries as the yin and the yang, the Apollonian and the Dionysian, order and chaos, good and evil, Luke Skywalker and Darth Vader. In the context of entrepreneurship, technological innovation and rapid societal change, this duality is expressed as neophobia and neophilia. Neo is Greek for new, Phobos was the ancient Greek deity of horror, and Philos means the love of. Neophobia and neophilia thus mean the fear of the new and the love of the new. The struggle between these two forces is legitimate, and they depend on one another. Love of the new without fear leads to recklessness. Fear of the new without curiosity leads to stagnation.
I'm not coming up. It's too dangerous for such very small animals.
Appropriately balanced, these two impulses unite to form a progressive dialectic through which curiosity and exploration continues in a measured and rational form, balanced by skepticism and a desire to protect oneself. In contemporary society, we can see these two forces manifest as expressions of innovation and regulation, as exploration and provinciality, as freedom and control. When Italian Renaissance man and astro-scientist Galileo in 1616 was called before Pope Paul V and ordered to renounce his heliocentric model, that is, the belief that the Earth revolves around the Sun, it was an expression of neophobia and a desire to maintain a familiar model of the world. In the 18th century, when the Luddites, that is, British opponents of the Industrial Revolution, tried to halt the progression of technology by destroying the automatic spinning machine, they were representing the force of neophobia. In the 19th century, during the height of the Industrial Revolution, neophobia manifested repeatedly by denouncing the flood of new inventions as dangerous, immoral, and unhealthy. The locomotive was claimed to be too fast and was claimed to make people hurt their necks and go insane. The refrigerators were claimed to poison food. The telephone would alienate people. The light bulb make people go blind, and so on and so on. However, as we moved on, the shock of the new was internalized, accepted. It was neophilia that made our ancestors leave the trees. It was neophilia that let mankind, at great risk and peril, tame fire. It was neophilia that led to the invention of the spoken language, the innovation of the wheel and irrigated farming. Neophilia changes our world and our perception of our place in it. The neophobes oppose and fear this change and instead emphasize nostalgia, tradition, and humility before an idealized state of naturalness expressed as Jean-Jacques Rousseau's noble savage.
The voices of our ancestors.
In today's society, neophobia uses climate change as an excuse for regressing society, raising questions on whether civilization is sustainable at all. The challenges mankind are facing can never be resolved by attempting to return to an idealized, romantic, and nostalgic ideal, any more than it is possible for a grown man to return to the tranquility of the primordial sea in his mother's womb. When civilizations collapse, it is because the forces of neophilia and neophobia become disjointed. The neophiles move on while the governments implode with neophobia. The Byzantine Collapse is a well-known example of this type of disjointed implosion, as the political leadership degenerated under rampant, nostalgic neophobia. It quickly lost the respect of the people. As a response to this, the ruling class imposed oppressive taxation policies to regain respect and to replenish the dwindling wealth of the empire, which naturally failed, as it merely aggravated the loss of respect in the provinces. Once the tax system started to implode due to falling revenues, so did the institutions that upheld administration. As the bureaucracy and record-keeping collapsed, society degenerated and knowledge started being lost. As a result of the loss of knowledge, the economy shrank and localized, and in many regions, people had to start doing things on their own rather than relying on the imports sustained by the infrastructure of the empire, only to realize that they simply couldn't. In the end, there wasn't anyone left who knew how to make concrete. No one had the technological know-how on how to make things they recently had taken for granted. In 1975, when I was born, it had been a mere 3 years since someone last visited the moon. A year later, the world's first commercial supersonic passenger plane, the Concorde, was introduced, a marvel of engineering and neophilia. The Concorde allowed passengers to travel from Paris to New York in a mere 3.5 hours and represented class, sophistication, and a bright new future in which no place on Earth was more than a few hours away. Supersonic means that the Concorde flew at Mach 2, twice the speed of sound, at over 1,000 miles per hour, faster than the Earth spins. This meant that you could arrive in New York at the same time as you departed from Europe.
Yeah, and it's always exciting to get to New York before you've left.
The Concorde soared so high that you could observe the curvature of the Earth through its windows. And then we lost it. In 2003, the Concorde was retired as unsustainable. A disastrous crash combined with the airline industry crisis following in the wake of the 9/11 attacks was the final nail in the coffin, and the Concorde was finally retired for good. We now live in a world where we used to be able to travel faster than we now are capable of. We live in a world that used to put men on the moon, but have stopped doing so. We now live in a world where we're asked not to innovate, but to downscale, to live simpler, to consume less, to travel not even by regular airplanes, but by train or even by foot. This is disjointed neophobian degeneration. For anything that lives either grows or dies, there is no standing still. The conclusion is that governments fail at executing these visionary projects by throwing taxpayers' money at long-term, unsustainable business models. But the problem is not with the vision. It lies in the execution. As the Nobel Prize-winning economist Milton Friedman once remarked, it is very hard to do good things with other people's money. And as the governments now are succumbing to climate-driven neophobia under the weight of their failures, it is important to remember that the innovations and visions that have always propelled our civilization forward originates in the hearts and minds of brave individuals. The miracle of the electrified metropolis of New York, so easily taken for granted until it's lost in the dead darkness of neophobia. Listen to its citizens revel as neophilian light and power is restored after last week's blackout. A feat damn near a miracle made possible only by generations of human labor, bravery and exploration. Man-made mountains filled with light and life, like spires of brilliant, intelligent defiance jutting through the darkness of ignorance. Where bureaucracy fails at sustaining a supersonic passenger plane, or building a space station in orbit around the moon, the private sector must now step in and take its appropriate place as the Prometheus of civilization. For it should be intolerable for any neophilian lover of freedom, enterprise and discovery to live in a world where we travel slower than we used to, where we no longer soar where we used to be able to soar, where we no longer take individual small steps that amount to giant new leaps for all mankind by putting brave men on the moon, on Mars, and elsewhere in an infinite journey of self-discovery and exploration. And to the neophobes, to the fearmongers, to the advocates of regression and celebrators of primitivism, I say, give me death or give me liberty, for your world is sick with the decay of yesterday while I long for tomorrow. I kneel in humbled admiration before the fact that we once put a man on the moon, and as God is my witness, this grandiose bravery will not be the last of its kind. It will be the first of many to come, and it will be the rightful neophilian visionaries of private enterprise that will do it. Do you think progression and innovation are better suited for solving the challenges facing mankind rather than regression and cessation? Are you interested in learning more about this approach that I call existential entrepreneurship? I'm considering launching a form of boot camp for young entrepreneurs, so if this sounds like your cup of tea, please drop me a line in the comment section down below. It will help me to gauge interest. Please share this video and subscribe to my YouTube channel. My name is Henrik Jönsson, and I value a small step forward for a single, bright individual higher than the regressive stepping back of the fearful masses. Thank you very much for watching this video. Please, I urge you, keep boldly going where no man has gone before.
Space, a final frontier.